You're locked in. You're listening to 97.5 All In Radio, where we have real-life conversations about real-life situations, and we play gospel music from artists worldwide. Stay locked in. One God, one love. 97.5 All In Radio.
Hey, what's good, ladies and gentlemen? God's beautiful people, I want to welcome everybody right here to 97.5 All In Radio. This is the One My. You heard me? Yes, indeed. Thank you so much. I was just reminiscing about one of my brothers, man, Quad Ace, man. Just kind of reminiscing of back then. It was just tickling me. How I used to get on his nerve back then. You heard me? We're going to talk about that, though, one day. You heard me? To God be the glory. I want to welcome everybody right here to One Mind. One Mind, the state of being one mind with others for the sake of accomplishing the will of God in homes, the church, and the community. That's what One Mind is all about. Right here on 97.5 All In Radio broadcast. Podcast, forgive me. It's a broadcast within a podcast. You heard me? Yes, indeed. So thank y'all for tuning in, man. We got something great for y'all today. We have coming up today, we have African Youth Talk, Kenya TV 47. We have gang members encounter with God. And we have a young lady that I scroll across YouTube, and I guess it was meant. You heard me, to God be the glory. Her name is Tanya O'Keel. Really, it's a video that I broke down, that I dropped down to audio. You heard me? Because you're going to hear her speak about a video. So it's really a video that I broke down to audio. I think it's very powerful. And I truly think it'll be a blessing to a lot of people out there right now. You heard me? And we still reaching for that 100,000 worldwide listeners. To God be all the glory. I want to give a big shout out to Pod Addict, those who describe it as Pod Addict and Pod Chaser. And Spotify. So God bless y'all. And also big shout out to Spreaker. You heard me? Yes, indeed. So thank y'all for tuning in. We got something powerful coming up today. You heard me? One God, one love. This is your truly Yosa King. 97.5 All In Radio. Welcome to One Minds. You already know what time it is if you've been tuning in. Come back with me, family. You heard me?
Yeah. Somebody pray for me. many people hollered in and tried to tear me apart. Had to cut them people off and gave my life to the Lord. Cause I need guidance and direction, I don't know where I'm going. Not many people get a second chance to get right with God. When the doctor said I wouldn't make it, yeah, somebody pray for me. And I just wanna say thank you, thinking of me, yeah.
I'm talking about
Listening to 97.5 All In Radio, where we have real life conversations about real life situations, and we play gospel music from artists worldwide. Stay locked in. One God, one love. 97.5 All In Radio.
Yes, indeed. Welcome back, family. To God be all the glory. One God, one love. Now we got it coming up. You heard me. But first, before we get into that, these three powerful messages today. You heard me. To God be the glory. Listen, I want to give a big shout out to the artist. Man, my boy, man. Bruh, if you hear this, sometimes I have trouble pronouncing your name. Not just your name, a lot of people's name. Y'all pray for me. I'm really doing my best to work on it. You heard me, family? Yes, indeed. My brother, Antonio. Man, see, I pronounced your name wrong, bro. Tonio Armina, Army. Somebody pray for me. That brother be making some powerful records, man. I ain't lying. To God be the glory. And Higher by Zay Solomon, featuring Mr. Charles, written by Joseph Gamish, produced by R. Green. They're out of the city of Orlando, Florida, and Sanford, Florida. You heard me, family? So big up to them. To God be the glory. And now coming, without further ado, family, yes, indeed, the message for the day, you heard me? So tune in, one God, one love. Welcome, you are now tuned in right here, and you are most welcome, you heard me? One mind, yes, indeed, to God be the glory. One mind, the state of being one mind with others for the sake of accomplishing the will of God in the home, the church, and the community. That's what we all about. Yes, indeed. Welcome to One Minds right here on 97.5 All In Radio Podcast. To God be the glory, family. Yes, indeed.
Welcome to the second part of our special program co-produced with TV47. I'm Beatrice Marshall with CGTN.
And I'm Victor Muyakane with TV 47.
Victor, in our last episode, we talked about the massive potential of Africa's youth. What impressed you the most?
Oh, wow. I was impressed by the grasp on the issues that the young people have. It looks as if Africa's youth, I mean, the leadership of Africa is using a massive 10,000 horsepower bulldozer as a school bus. There's a massive underutilization of African youth for African solutions to African problems. And that's what really impressed me. But also that there's so much potential. There's clarity of vision, clarity of ideas, and ingenuity and resilience, persistence and hope.
Indeed, a lot of potential with African youth. In this week's program, however, we'll explore ways to empower our youth in Africa. Before we do that, let me introduce our guests here in Nairobi, Casmuel Makure, artist and youth activist, and also with me in Nairobi, Nerima Wako Ojiwa, executive director at Siasa Place. Also joining us
via Zoom is Edwin Ikworia, an international development and policy advocacy expert, joining us from London. And we also are joined by an audience of students from Daystar University in Nairobi. Welcome to you all.
Edwin, let me come to you here, because it is now widely acknowledged that Africa does indeed have a youth crisis at all levels, but also a huge potential. So let's talk solutions. If you can mention just one thing in each case, what lesson can African countries learn from elsewhere, and which homegrown solutions it must devise?
The German case is a key example where they have the dual education system. And the idea here is that you do not need to be a degree holder for you to be functional in society, for you to be recognized as an expert, as a skilled person in your work. That fusing of apprenticeship, working with the private sector to make sure that young people are getting the needed experience and the government paying for that. That's the key thing I really think Africa can learn from that. Working with the private sector who are job creators, who are investing in their businesses, who need these employees, by the way, train them on the job. They get a stipend for that. And then these people come out skilled and experienced, and then they get absorbed by the industry. That is a key example that I think Africa can borrow from. Another one that I thought was key is the idea of transforming the agricultural sector. And I think the example of China is quite key here, where because Africa particularly has a large portion of their population involved in the agricultural sector, as long as agricultural productivity is still very low, it is very discouraging for young people. And so whatever investment we can put in the sector to transform the sector to a modern way of farming and producing food and producing textile and cotton and granite and horticulture, whatever that is not with the drudgery of cutlers and hoes as it was in those olden days, young people will flock into that system, and that itself can generate a lot of opportunities for African young people. So in terms of solutions, those are some of them. And for homegrown ones, I think Rwanda is a key example of how they're infusing technical and vocational education training with the education system, mm-hmm. how they are putting a lot of money through the Young Entrepreneurs Fund, you know, to provide capital that African young people need, you know, to get into new startups and producing, using their innovation to produce new services and even creating markets for agricultural products. Those are examples that I think Africa can really leverage to engage its young people.
You've talked about how young people want to take charge of their future through governance. You look at Africa's leadership tends to be on the maturer side. How do we integrate younger people into leadership positions?
Many of them are trying within political parties. Because of the system that we have, to enter, you enter in a political party. Very few people actually make it in as an independent candidate. When we look at the statistics of our political parties, majority of the actual party members are young people. But the ones who participate in the primaries, you hardly see the large number of young people participating. And even those who try, parties find ways to put the people who have paid for the ticket on the ballot. And that's where a lot of young people get locked out. But if they organize now, start joining parties now, start getting voters' cards now, they will be able to influence parties from within. Because what I see as a challenge in our country, the laws are there, the policies are there. Politics is about who gets what and how. If you don't have the right person saying, we need this to go here this way, we've lost the game.
Right. Casmuel, I want to come to you because you're talking about, and you talked in your previous program about reimagining a new continent, how to get there, you know, how to reconfigure society. What do young people want to see in a new Africa?
I think I would be preposterous to speak for all young people, but I would try and maybe paint a picture. We want an Africa in which we can thrive, because currently, as things stand, we are barely surviving. And that's why you will find, if you think about it, the correlation of the youth bulge, even with violence, you'll find that if you were to think about it critically, the people who have like the highest tendency to be suicide bombers are very highly educated men in the engineering field. If you think about these moving parts, we would need, one, a system that works for us and not us finding ways to integrate into the current system, us finding ways to rethink the system. And that might necessarily mean phasing out the people who are holding on to these punitive practices. And that's part of what the youth are agitating for. In so doing, once we've eased off the pressure from a political point, because I also believe the personal is political, once we've eased off into good governance and tapping into our potential, it's important for us as young people to be allowed to chart our own paths, make new mistakes, figure life out on our own, try and say that this is what we think we would, this is the direction we would love to go. Because a lot of people are stuck in history to say that this has not worked for us before. It's like driving while looking in the rear view. We will have to get to the point where we've rid ourselves of the shackle of the fear of what could it be, or this is what has not worked for us before, into imagining a new world for ourselves.
Right. Edwin, I want to get your thought here. How can this new Africa, or this new look that the African youth want, how can that be achieved? And can it be achieved?
It will be achieved. It's not even it can it be. It will be achieved. It's either whether it's achieved through a normal process or transition, or it gets achieved by violence. One of the things that I know young people have been doing, and that has been working and celebrated globally, is our culture and arts, which I think my colleague in the studio would totally agree. One of the biggest exports of the African continent is the arts, right? And it's beginning to create a new narrative for the African continent in terms of its potential, in terms of the creativity. So it just requires you know, the right policy space to lean in into this new narrative that the potential is here. That is one. In terms of the natural resources that we've been blessed with, the question is about how do we transform the governance of the natural system by letting institutions work? And the case in point here is, as young people come together, as they organize more and organize better, they can use the existing laws to demand accountability. It is not even a lack of lack of policies. It's really about accountability for existing policies that can even lead to these transformations. So there is what we need to do on the African continent in terms of the governance, in terms of participation, in terms of inclusion. Inclusion not in a tokenistic way that it has been happening, but in a really integrated way that shows and leverages the strength of the young people. What does that mean? It means that young people get their quota to be in government. It is required by law that certain age restrictions are taken out of our constitutions, out of our electoral laws. It is required by law that a certain percentage of parliament must be these people, must be at this age, so that all the kinds of demographics are represented. I do believe that intergenerational dialogue is critical for this transformation to happen. So right. We do not necessarily need to take away those old people out so that young people can be there, but there needs to be a cross-fertilization. That is when we can truly get inclusive development.
All right. And still with you, Edwin, before we shift, apparently every year about 10 to 12 million young people enter the labor market, against a supply of about 3 million jobs, formal jobs for that matter. And observers have said that the starting point of changing this course needs to be, of course, rethinking our education systems. So I have a set of questions for you and everyone that we have here. First of all, what fundamental changes are needed in Africa's education system? You did touch on this a little bit earlier with your comparisons. And second, what are those in-demand skill sets today, in today's labor market in Africa, and indeed, how can we address the mismatch? Over to you, Edwin.
our education system is not matching with our sectors, not matching with this, with the opportunities that we have. So where we produce graduates of all kinds of disciplines, I do not want to mention specific one because no one is, I mean, there are a bunch of them that are not relevant for the industries that are in the on the ground. When I say industries, I do not mean manufacturing only. I mean, for instance, abundant arable lands we have on the African continent, abundant access to renewable energy that we have on the African continent, the infrastructural gaps that we have, the gaps in IT infrastructure that we have. All of these gaps, if we create our, if our education system is producing people to meet these gaps, and then we create an enabling environment for the investment to flow in, it is almost automatic that development would be the natural fallout of that. But our skills and our education system is designed to, you know, I would say, go up, you know, in the days of teach people to become workers in an industry that does not exist. That is a challenge. So fundamentally, we need to shift that and do a needs assessment. Mm-hmm. Every country on the African continent needs to ask, what are the sectors that are available in Africa, in this country, right, and which people do we need to work them? That is fundamental. Otherwise, we'll continue to churn out plenty graduates and out of that. Then the second thing I would say, I know that it's time, is how do we transform our informal system,
right,
our informal informal sectors? It is so fundamental. 80% of Africa's private sector is in the informal space. It means that we do not contribute to pension. We do not contribute to, in fact, we cannot even be taxed because we are not even known. Registration is very limited. And I think my sister talked about the fact that it is so cumbersome to register a company. How do we dismantle those structures to allow the informal sector become more formalized? And that in turn generates data. That data tells us how we can create more employment, how we can incentivize the system to produce more entrepreneurs. Those are some fundamental shifts that need to happen. Otherwise, more graduates, by the way, it is 62 million young people that are not in employment, not in training, and that are not gainfully employed in any way. That right. is disaster waiting to happen. We need to emphasize that.
So, Nerima, I want to come back to the issue of leadership and how the youth can take up the leadership mantle. But first of all, do you think young people want to lead?
Yes, I know they want to lead. In 2022, when we look at the number of young people who actually stood up for elective politics, it was almost 2,500 of them. Mm-hmm. Those who were elected, young women, the number actually dropped. Only 14 young women got elected, while the rest are nominated. Majority are nominated. And when we talk about young men, about 380 were elected. So the number is increasing for men. For women, it's actually just increasing very, very little. Our politics is becoming more violent. But leadership is not just political leadership. There's leadership everywhere. And so even when we look at business, when we look at other sectors, technology, we're seeing young people with very innovative ideas and working really hard to be able to lead in their industries.
Right.
Yeah, so yes, they want to lead.
Well, they do want to lead. And, you know, still on the subject of youth and leadership, Kasmil, it appears inclusion is no longer the aim. You know, it's not just about a seat at the table. They want a place in the kitchen.
Right.
Talk to us about what proposals you have that can allow young people to be integrated into those levels of leadership that Nerima was talking about, political, academia, tech, industry, spiritual even.
Right. I think a lot of this comes with time because just also as we've set it, as our culture dictates, is that there's an age hierarchy type of thing, and there are certain positions which you can only occupy once you're at, they take a bit of time. Like, for example, if you're going to be a professor, and going back to what's a problem which I think made our industries awash with horrible professors, is you would just become a professor because you would bring the most funding to a department of a university, not because you were actually interested in that. And you would find at some point people thought the best way into public service was through the universities. Mm-hmm. So nobody was educating people because they actually love to educate. They were looking at that not as an end, but as a means to public service. So in the over-glorification of these political posts, mm-hmm. we find that we lose a lot of value. So part of what we need to do as young people in that kitchen, making, in getting into the kitchen process, is by collaboration and not control. So part of what we do is building up on the work such that I do not have to start another organization, mm-hmm. because Nerima runs Siasa Place, and there's a lot of ground they've covered in terms of political and legal growth. Mm-hmm. I will onboard myself as a person who's very vocal as a leader and say, hey, Nerima, I need to know what I need to do to navigate these kinds of spaces.
All right.
The only way we will integrate and come to that table, mm-hmm. and even rebuild, is if we collaborate. And the thing which unites us is, you know, all of us are not doing well financially. So part of our struggles are going to unite us and help us, I think, tie us together. If we collaborate, we do not even need to integrate, because if we were to run an election just based on the youth without touching any of the votes of the two proposed in our false dilemma, we could still come up with a president. So it's part of doing those things, the collaboration and the re-education and the reimagination of our politics.
So, Edwin, let me bring this to you. You know, it does seem that the young people want to be heard. It does seem that the young people want to be on the table. What are the most effective ways, in your view, to engage the youth to ensure that those voices are heard and heard clearly?
Young people are already leading. It is just that we don't have a critical mass yet. And that's what we need to get to. What do I mean by that? Take about the fintech space. It's amazing how young Kenyans, how young Nigerians, how young South Africans, how young Africans are taking over the fintech space. And I thought we should mention that. So in terms of politics, they may not have been there yet. But if you take over the industry, and this is what I want to emphasize, if you take over the industry, you take over the academia, even in academics, I agree that you need a long time to become a professor. But I tell you that most of the young researchers today are young people. I mean, researchers who are innovating, who are expanding the frontiers of knowledge, are young people. Go all over Europe. You see young Africans dominating the landscape. And I really want us to recognize that. But it's not a critical mass yet. And I think the question of collaboration and finding opportunity, and when you get there, creating opportunity for others to come into the space, is mm-hmm. one key way to go. So, but in politics, there are some fundamental changes that needs to happen on the African continent. First of all, is money politics. Because when you put money at the top of the political agenda, young people may not be able to find their way there because they haven't made money. And so we need to think about, how do we demonetize politics in Africa so that when you are qualified and you are interested and you are passionate, you can really participate. And I think our colleague in the studio talked about the fact that a number of people will contest, but very few get elected. And I can tell you that within party structures, they are not able to afford even the nomination fees or the fees to buy the forms to be able to contest, even though you are in the parties. They are afraid of the power of the young people. But when young people demonstrate value, they are given the space. I can tell you, Rwanda is still an example. Even though people have different dimensions of that, the number of young people in the civil service, it's amazing, it's transformational. Because they are innovative, they are capable. And when they got the opportunity, they actually lead to transformation. So digital cities are run by young people. So if we are able to create value, I mean, demonstrate value, we will get the opportunity because of the value we bring. So young people should continue to demonstrate value and they will get there. But the political environment needs to be reformed to allow that to happen. And right. that takes political will. And I'm not sure we have reached there yet in Africa.
Right, right. Now, to our audience, I noticed some of you were just enraptured by what was going on. You were nodding quite seriously. Have you got a question or a comment on this? Anyone indeed that has? Yes, please. Let's have your question.
Thank you. My name is Michelle Kaibere. I'm an author, a student at Daystar, taking communication, electronic media. I love that we have talked much about good governance, but I think we are forgetting to emphasize on the other tenet that is deeply interconnected with good governance, and that is good leadership. And my question goes to Cosmo. How do we teach our parents and part of the youth to stop choosing leaders based on their ability to rabble-rouse and choose leaders because they have built capacity to solve issues that are in our country? Thank you.
I am a firm believer that we need functional systems. I believe in structure of a form, mm-hmm. such that if you have good structures, even if we elect a bad person, it would work still. So I don't believe that systems should be dependent on the goodness of a person. Because then what happens if, God forbid, the good person dies? Ideally, the systems are supposed to be there. But what we're realizing is while we are, our tribe is the constitution. That's what the Gen Zs have said. We are tribe Katiba. Katiba is Swahili for constitution. As we build good structures, let's also find good people to show us how these structures would run, such that we have a good car right. with an experienced driver. So part of what we need to do is not necessarily cause like an uprising or whatnot. What we need to do is, one, as we keep on changing our culture, also try and push for good structures. And if we have good structures that are working, have good people in those structures, we can always do that. It could be elective, it could be... I don't believe it will be with these people, right. but more people of our generation need to rise up right. and occupy these spaces.
So let me talk to people of your generation.
Right.
Is there a sense of hopelessness or is there a sense of hope for the future potential?
There's absolutely a sense of hope. If we were hopeless, we would not be doing this. And I think that's why even these kinds of questions are coming and we're asking ourselves, that's why we are not worried. If you ask any Gen Z, so what next? They're like, I don't know, we're just vibing. We're like, yeah, we'll figure it out. But then the older generation, how I know this is a person I don't want to waste my time talking to, mm-hmm. is if they're obsessed with the question, what next? Because the people who are obsessed with the question, what next, are part of the establishment that are worried. But we're like, the system that we have currently did not work for our grandparents, did not work for our parents, did not work for our elder siblings. We're still unemployed and they're asking us, what next? We're like, currently, this is not working. So we are imagining, and that's why I'm saying, don't you dare lose hope. Don't you dare buy into the narrative of people asking what could be next. All I'm saying is, let us work together in the imagination of a beautiful, possible future that we have not yet conceptualized. And the only way we can bring that is by collaborative thinking and by us daring to occupy.
All right, right. Do you have a question from the audience? Yes, please.
Hi, my name is Ingrid Wanjera-Kalsvik. I am a DESTA student studying communication. My question would be to Edwin. He touched on unlearning and resolving the financial aspect in determining leaders and everything. If it was up to you, how would you tell that somebody is fit to be a leader in, like, if it was put in your hands entirely, like you determine and give us a list of how to find the right candidate?
Just show me what you've done before. Show me how you have succeeded in business. Show me how you succeeded in school. Show me how you have made progress with your previous assignment. You do not just aspire to leadership if you cannot demonstrate that you've done this in the past. That's what is called meritocracy. But when you come in and do rabble rousing, like somebody mentioned in the hall, without anything to show about your past competence, I will not vote for you. And I think that is the main challenge we have with African politics. We do not display, we do not showcase our competence. We showcase our tribe. We showcase our religion. We showcase how much money we have and begin to use money to politicize. I think for me, that is the fundamental challenge. If I don't see your past, if I don't see your credibility, if I don't see your credentials, I should never vote for you. And I think our politics should begin to go in that direction.
So I want to get to your final comment. And let me start with you, Kasmo. If you are to recommend a way forward, what is the one essential issue you think should be implemented in order to transform Africa's youth bulge from potential to a demographic dividend?
I would still say we need a political awakening, and I hate to be that guy, but the personal is deeply political. And for us to do that, it will be for us to rethink and reimagine what the world is. I think part of it will be for us to establish goodwill amongst each other and for us to see who's looking for the most amount of collective good. Because then it means, as a young person, the only time I will be able to enter politics for me to have anything substantial is in my 30s. But we are saying, and I think these questions just show that these things work because we are at that tipping point. For us to actualize our potential into kinetic or electric and whatever, we will also need to, one, as we unshackle mm-hmm. ourselves from the burden of debt in the West, that still ties back to good governance. As we reaffirm our identity and reclaim our pride as Africans and remembering that we are so incredibly enough that we do not have to talk a certain kind of way for us to be acceptable. Mm-hmm. We do not have to walk or dress a certain kind of way. And you've seen this where as a young person, you have more privilege if you're in a suit than if you're in ragged jeans and dreadlocks. So in trying to do those kinds of things, in the shifting our culture and our politics mentally, we will be able to transform that, because there is a lot of very important information that we miss out on because we think that fluency in English equates to intelligence. We think that if somebody speaks with an accent, they are less intelligible. But as long as we still think like that, the way we can change this effectively is in going into those two places, in our politics and in our education, so that as a society we can come up to this collective social conscience of accepting each other so that we can be able to grow in leaps and bounds. But as long as we're still beholden to the appeal of the Western gaze, we will not be able to see ourselves. We'll just be white people in black skins.
Nerima?
Find something that interests you. Something that interests you. And then find the linkages of how it's connected to governance, how it's connected to politics. Talk about it in your circles. Even if it's every other weekend, make sure it comes up in conversation and share. It's to learn more. Civil disobedience works. What do I mean? Continue shunning the terrible leaders that are around us. It's hurting them. Continue to show publicly that you do not agree with their behavior and you're not willing to put them back into leadership. So that also creates a community of supporting good behavior. And then that way we can also begin to encourage good leaders to enter leadership. So continue to push for accountability even when it's hard.
Edwin, you have the final word.
Accountability is the basis of any society. If our leaders are not accountable to us, we have a saying that the highest office in the land is the office of the citizen. So when young people get involved and see themselves as citizens having the highest authority to determine whether somebody stays in power or otherwise, to that extent we can demand accountability. And that is why I would call on every young person to say, do your best, do your bit in whatever sphere you find yourself first. Demonstrate your capacity. Demonstrate that you are really able to mobilize the collective good. And through that, a critical mass of people with having the same aspiration for collective good can transform governance. And that is why we can demand accountability and get it when we have a critical mass. And I think that, for me, the fundamental shift is that institutions must work and not personalities. And that process can enable us really transform our governance and transform our economies. I would rest my case there.
Very interesting discussion indeed on the potential of Africa's youth. But that's all we have time for on this special edition of Talk Africa, co-produced with TV47. A big thank you to our panel of experts, Kasamuel Makuri, artist and youth activist, Nerima Wako Ojiwa, executive director at Siasa Place, Edwin Ikuhoria, international development and policy advocacy expert. And thank you to our audience, students from Daystar University. Thank you very much for joining us today. Remember, you can be a part of this conversation through our social media platforms on Facebook and X. And you can watch this and other editions of Talk Africa on our YouTube playlist. Do join us again next week for more Talk Africa.
This has been a co-production between CGTN and TV47. We took 2 weeks to talk to young people about the challenges that they're facing, the potentials, and indeed how to empower them. Do let us know what you think about this particular subject. My name is Victor Muyakane from TV47. We'll see you again, but for now, it's goodbye.
You're locked in. You're listening to 97.5 All In Radio, where we have real-life conversations about real-life situations, and we play gospel music from artists worldwide. Stay locked in. One God, one love. 97.5 All In Radio.
I was raised here in Pasco, Washington. As I was growing up here, I grew up in a split home. So my mom and my dad were always arguing and fighting. And there was really no attention on me and my siblings. So in the middle of all this, I kind of just started hanging out with the wrong crowd, and I was able to get out of the house with nobody really like paying attention to me. So I ended up becoming involved in this gang and in this lifestyle with drugs and kind of like trying to fit in and be a part of the scene, because I really don't have a father figure. You know, like my dad's always gone. So these gang members that I'm being surrounded by, they become my father figure. And I see that as they're people that get respected and people that get looked up to in the school. So that's who I want to be. And so I end up becoming involved with these gangs. And at the age of 15, we get arrested and stuff. I get arrested for a possession of a firearm charge. And I end up going to do some time for this, for a minor in possession of a firearm charge. And I end up doing some time for that. When I get out, I get kicked out of school. And so it just kind of makes me get more involved in the gang, because I don't have to go to school now. So I'm kind of more in the mix of all the gang stuff. And at the age of 20, I'm about to turn 21, I get arrested for a felony rioting charge and felon in possession of a firearm. And I end up having to go do a prison sentence. So a friend of mine, two friends of mine got shot. And now they're saying that, now I'm starting kind of catching up on everything that's been going on. And another friend of mine got shot, and he got shot in the finger in his head. But he survived and he was good. And as we're driving down Core Street, the rival gang pulls up right next to us. And at first I don't notice it, but I hear like someone yelling and stuff. And so I roll down the window and I notice that it's these guys, you know. And I have my kids in the back, in the car seats and stuff. And so they're over here, and one of the guys waves a gun. And I mean, I had a gun as well in the car at the time, but I didn't want to shoot or do anything because my kids were in the car. And so I told my friend, I was like, hey, just take me home. And I kind of sit there and with the kids, and I'm kind of panicked a little bit too, because the situation could have gotten really bad. And I knew if they would have shot the car, they would have shot my kids or just the car alone. So this girl tells me that that I should go to church and stuff like that. And so I go to church, and I'm at the church, and the message that they were preaching kind of was speaking to me, like to what was going on in my situation there in that time. I wasn't a person that had a lot of patience, so I want stuff to happen immediately. And stuff's not happening for me. It's already been like a couple weeks, and Pastor Tony had gave me this Bible, and I'm reading scriptures and all this stuff. And I was like, man, like I've been praying and nothing's really happening. I'm already looking for other alternatives to, instead of just waiting for God to come through to like start selling drugs or something so that I could get myself back on my feet. And that week I had gone with my brother and gone to a dispensary, because when I went into prison, there was no dispensaries and I got out and weed was legal. So I had gone with my brother and we had been smoking dabs. And now I'm here like a couple weeks later, and I know it takes more than 30 days to get clean. And my probation officer calls me and he tells me like, hey, you need to come in. You were supposed to be here yesterday. And he pulls out a UA cup and he tells me, he goes, can you give me a UA? And so I kind of stared at it for a little bit. And I was like, oh, yeah, yeah. And he tells me, he's like, are you clean? And I don't know if he could tell that I was, like, nervous. And I told him, I was like, oh, yeah, yeah, of course, yeah. I was like, I'm clean. But I remember I was saying this little short prayer, and I was like, God, I was like, if you're real, I need you to show up, like, right now. I need you to help me. So when he gives me the cup, I look at the cup, and I'm clean. Like THC is all normal. Everything is normal. And I'm kind of like... at all a little bit, I'm kind of like, oh my gosh, like I'm clean, you know. As we're driving back home and stuff, my sister was a Christian, and she was also trying to get me to church, and I just never really went with her. So she's listening to this radio station called K-Love, and as we're driving, there's this guy, and he comes out and he's on the radio, and his name's Luis Pallon, and he's talking about how in the Hebrew language there's no word for coincidence. And he was saying that is happening is because God's ordained it that way, and that the Hebrews believed in that, and that So the sooner that we stop saying that it's not a coincidence or that it's luck, but we start acknowledging that it's God, that the more we'll see the blessings poured out upon us. And it just, like, to me, it just hit me, and it hit me hard. Like, God was, like, telling me, like, no. And he's like, it's not a coincidence. Like, it's me, you know? Like, all this stuff that's been happening positively is me, you know? And so I'm looking out the window, and I'm just kind of, like, lost. And so as we drive home, I turn around and look at my sister, and I'm like, kind of emotional. Now I'm just seeing God move, and, like, I could just see him, that he's all over me. He's kind of like pushing me to do, like, go to church. And he's like, I feel like he's just answering me. Like, everything that I'm asking is just happening fast. And I get to church, and the service that they're having is just, it just hits me again. And God's all over me. And I just feel like emotional. And they call people up, and they're like, if you've never given your life to God or to Christ, come to the altar. I'm just, like, emotionally broken, and I start crying at the altar. So I cut out, like, everything. I cut out the relationships, other friends and stuff like that. Like, I go back, and I kind of just go back into my word, go back into prayer, go back into having a relationship with God. And moving forward, I cut out doing tattoos, because I was doing tattoos as well. And I know that was something that God wanted me to cut out. So that was something that was hard for me, because I was making good money, and it was something I didn't want to let go, because as a kid I was always, like, drawing and doing art. So I ended up cutting that out too. And I already knew that it wasn't what I wanted, that it's what God wants. And that's what brings me joy, is doing what God wants. So that's what I decided to do, and that's what I'm going to continue to decide to do as I continue forward.
You're tuning in now, you're listening to 97.5. We bringing you the gospel, right out of the state of Indiana. 97.5, All In Radio.
Hey, what's good, family? I want to thank everybody for tuning in today right here on One Mind, 97.5, All In Radio. All In Radio podcast, to God be the glory. Thank you so much. We truly appreciate you. Yes, indeed. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your support. And listen, to become a member right here, if you would love to become a member right here on One Mind, all you have to do, family, is sign in and just leave a comment. That's it. And you're a member. You heard me? To God be the glory. One Mind, the state of being in one mind with others for the sake of accomplishing the will of God in the home, the church, and the community. To God be the glory. Yes, indeed, family. And today's One Mind broadcast is sponsored by New Good Hope Missionary Baptist Church under the leadership of Pastor Brian Watkins, 112 Fulton Street, Buchanan, Michigan, 49107-269-409-8183. Email address is newgoodhopembc2@gmail.com. Their motto is to love, learn, listen, and to live for the Lord. You heard me? And also, today's broadcast is sponsored by LTIA, Let's Turn It Around Organization, out of South Bend, Indiana. Co-founder, Mr. Lynn Coleman, that's against gun violence around the world and every walks of life, every culture. It's about unity, getting our neighborhood back. You understand? With love, peace, and unity from all walks and culture of life. LTIA, Let's Turn It Around Organization. And you also can reach them at www.ltia.net. You heard me? Yes, indeed. And thank you so much. I truly appreciate you for tuning in today. I'm going to tell you something. Listen to me real carefully, family. You heard me? When you sit, I sit back and I enjoyed both of them. To God be the glory. I truly did. And I always, you know, keep notes and, you know, do my best to chart things down. You heard me? Yes, indeed. And when it comes to everything that you listen to, both of the messages today, man, if you just try to look at it from a biblical perspective, you know, it's revelation. Politics is politics all around the world. People fighting for a better way of life, from poverty, educational system, food crisis, gang violence, police violence, corrupt pastors that's in bed with corrupt government. You understand? And this is real life. So we have to stay prayed up to God be the glory, and we have to come together in one body in Christ. We say we are Christians, so we have to truly come together in one body of Christ. You heard me? It is just what it is, you dig? That's just real life. You heard me, family? So thank you so much. I want to give a big shout out to my cousin. I love you, my big cousin. Reason I call her my big cousin, because she's, you know, older than me. So that's my big cousin, Linda Hart. God bless you. Happy birthday, my precious cousin. I love you dearly. I want to give a big shout out to her brother, my cousin. We really grow up like brothers and sisters. So they mom, the late Miss Josephine Hart, that's my auntie. I love her. So I miss her so much too, for real. She gonna keep teaching God to you. Every time you come around, I'm trying to tell you. Yes, indeed. Big shout out to the Hart and Gamish family. Big shout out to all my beautiful, wonderful people. Big shout out to Avon Park, Florida. Big shout out to Orlando, Florida. Big shout out to God's beautiful people. You heard me. Big shout out to Tallahassee, Florida. Big shout out worldwide. To God be the glory. Big shout out to Africa, in Jesus Christ's name. I want to say something. Big shout out to my cousin, Robert Hart. I love you, cousin. Yes, indeed. Roosevelt Hart, the whole Hart family. You feel me? Yes, indeed. And big shout out to my brother, Lawson, out there in Washington, D.C. Love you, brother. One God, one love. Big shout out to the whole Florida Boys. You heard me? Yes, indeed. The Florida Boy album coming. Best believe it is, I get people be hollering at me about it. Man, when you say the album coming this summer, man, when the album coming? We had some little situations that, you know, but we working it out. You heard me? It's coming. To God be the glory. And thank you once again, man. I want to give my thanks to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ in heaven. Without God, none of this would be possible. So I'm grateful, and we're going to do our best to do better every single day, because God made us. We are great. You heard me? Don't let nobody tell you nothing different. Have a positive way of thinking. The Bible say, let the weak say they are strong. You understand? Say you are strong. And that God placed a lot of greatness inside of you. You understand? And you are great. To God be the glory. Keep that in mind. You heard me? And I also want to give a big shout out to Greater Friendship Missionary Baptist Church out of South Bend, Indiana, under the leadership of Pastor Larry Davis. Yes, indeed. I want to give a big shout out to all the ministers. You heard me? Up under the leadership of Pastor Larry Davis. To God be the glory. So God bless you. Have a beautiful, blessed weekend. I want y'all to tune in, man, to Backyard Segment. Got some great things coming up this Saturday. It's going to be powerful. You heard me? It's just more than videos. Backyard Segment, it's just more than just playing videos. You dig? So we got a lot of stuff to talk about. Got a lot of stuff to rap with you about. My beautiful, beautiful, godly people. To God be the glory. I love you so much. Thank you for tuning in. Yes, indeed. One God, one love.
I know it for myself. I believe his word. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. You got to turn from your wicked ways. You got to seek my God's face. He will heal. He said it. I believe it. I trust him. I know it. He will heal the land. He will heal. He will heal. This land is full of trouble. This land is full of pain. This land is full of strife. This land is full of evil. But I know, no. He's gonna heal it. He's gonna heal it. If you just trust in him, if you just believe him, he will. He will. He will. He will.
You're locked in. You're listening to 97.5 All In Radio, where we have real-life conversations about real-life situations, and we play gospel music from artists worldwide. Stay locked in. One God, one love. 97.5 All In Radio.